Hi, and welcome to this first presentation on the on stage two on the second day of the develop conference. I will talk a bit about the configuration API and a bit what is it and how do you use it. So my name is Peter Wellman, and I'm an engineering manager with Milestone in the SDK team. The agenda for this presentation will be that I'll first give a bit of a small introduction to what the configuration API is. Then I'll dig a bit deeper into the more technical details on how to use it, and also do a demo on how to implement a small application using the configuration API. Then we'll move on to the latest addition to configuration API, which is configuration of rules. And at the end, we should also have some time for questions. So if you have any questions throughout the presentation, please feel free to write them in the chat, and I'll try to do my best to answer them at the end. So let's get started. First of all, so what is the purpose of the configuration API? Well, basically, the idea is to allow our partners to do automated configuration of pretty much the entire VMS without ever opening the management client. So it should be possible to configure any part of the VMS from your application. We also plan to base our own configuration tasks on the configuration API, and we have actually already done some parts of it, some parts of our own configuration using the configuration API. The strategy, we implemented the first parts of the configuration API came out in 2014, release of XProtect. And the strategy has since then been that we have tried to add bit by bit the different features to the configuration API. We knew already from the beginning that if we had to implement all of the configuration in one go, it would take a very long time until we will have anything available. So instead, we try to release with every version of XProtect a little bit, some more features into the configuration API. And we do this based on requests from partners. So if there is a part of the configuration API that is not yet, or a part of configuration that is not yet supported by configuration API and you need it, please let us know, and we'll try to take that into account when we prioritize the next releases. So let's go a bit more into the technology part. So what is the configuration API? Well, basically, it's just a web service or a SOAP interface. You'll find it on any management server under the management server / configuration API service .svc UI. It's a fairly simple SOAP interface with only, I guess, about 15 methods. And of these, you will actually normally only use like 5 of these. I'll get back to that on a later slide. We also have some helper classes in the VGOS.configurationAPI assembly. Those are not strictly necessary, as you'll see in the demo shortly. You can actually do an entire application using configuration API without using this DLL at all. But for some purposes, it helps you a bit. Finally, we have a set of what we call strongly typed classes, which are basically a one-to-one class representation of the different types that are in the configuration API. So if you are on the .NET platform and using the MIB SDK anyway, I strongly encourage you to use these configuration items instead of the maybe a bit more tedious raw configuration API. However, for this presentation, I will focus on the raw configuration API instead. So the current support, again, we are adding bit by bit, and this is a screenshot. Most of you will probably recognize the management client, and we've tried here to give an indication of what parts of the configuration can currently be configured using configuration API. And as you see, it's actually quite a big part. There are gaps yet, but we believe that we have taken most of the important parts of configuration and will of course continue to add more. You can see here that of course devices and so on can be configured. That was basically the first thing we added to configuration API, but since then all things like smart wall alarms, roles and also rules have now been added. So if I should give a percentage, I would say that we're probably around 80% coverage today. So going a step deeper, so how do you use the configuration API? Well, basically you access this service. I already mentioned that on a previous slide, in this case on my local host, but it could of course be on any machine running a management server. And when you access that, you'll see that there's the configuration service interface implementing, yeah, again, as I said, I think it's 15 methods or so, but in normal use, you'll just use the following five methods. The first one is get child items. So the configuration API, you will see that in a demo shortly, but the configuration API is basically a tree structure of nodes. And get child items will, for any node in the tree, return the immediate children under that node. Next is the get item. That's if you want to access configuration for a specific item and you already know the path of it, then you can get that using the get item method. Then next we have validate item and set item. So those are the ones you use if you want to update the configuration. So validate item is not strictly necessary to use, but we strongly encourage you to use it because it will actually ask the server to validate if the item you have now created, that if that's actually a valid item. And it will provide some quite good feedback on if it's not valid, what is actually the problem, and whereby allowing you to give some good information to either your users or the developer during development. So please, I suggest always use that. However, the set item, which is the one that actually saves the item on the server, will also internally validate this item. So if it's not valid, it will not be saved, and thus you cannot mess up the configuration. However, the error message you get back from set item is much more limited than what validate item can give you. Finally, we have invoke methods, which is a way to invoke specific methods that are supported for any specific type. We'll get back to some examples of the methods available and also see an example of where we actually use the invoke method. All of these work with configuration item, which is the main class of the entire configuration API. So get child items, get item will return instances of this, and validate item and set item takes an instance of configuration item as the parameters, and so do invoke method. And we will also see examples of this in a short while. Finally, path, that's how we identify any node in this tree structure. You'll see some examples of it, but basically it's a type name, could be for instance camera, followed by square brackets, and then inside the square brackets you will have the grid that designate the exact item. For those of you knowing the MIP API, you probably know already what we call FQID, and this is a bit different. But inside the FQID, you have what the object ID, which actually corresponds to the grid you see here. So there's a one-to-one correlation between most of these. So let's try to go to a demo and have a little bit of a more detailed look at of what is in the config API. The first thing I'll show you is one of the samples from the SDK. For learning how to code config API, I don't think it's the best sample, and I'll get back to some better suggestion for samples to look into for the code. But the config API client is actually a really good tool when you are developing using config API, because it gives you a good overview of what is available in the API. The API itself is totally generic, meaning that all information that is available in the config API client is not known by the client beforehand. It's something it reads from the server when it logs into it, and it simply asks the server at the top node, which will always be the management server. So we have the management server as the top node here, and you can see there are some properties for that as well, and as well as some methods. And then it will ask for child items from that, and then recursively go through each of the child items to read out okay, what methods are then available on that item, what properties are available on that item, and what child items again recursively. And if you look down here, you'll see that it's a structure. It's not exactly like what you know from management client, but it's also still, it is quite similar, and a lot of the nodes you will recognize. So you can see, I'll not go in a lot of details with them, but you can see that we have the rules, the roles, we have alarm definitions, we have basic users, camera groups, recording servers. Let's just click down a bit in that. So in this recording server, we will see a list of the drivers, but we can also see what hardware is available on it, and as well as the storage. And furthermore, if you go down in the hardware, you will be able to see, okay, what is on this hardware? Well, there's some cameras. So, okay, there are two cameras on this one, and so on and so on. And if we select a camera, we can now see what properties are available, and you can even change those properties using the config API client. But the main purpose of this is actually to give you an idea what is available in the API itself. One thing I want to point out is that down here, we have at the very bottom, it might be a bit hard to see, but down here you'll always see the path for the current node. So in this case, it's a camera with the square brackets and then the grid inside, the grid pointing to this specific camera. That can be quite useful, especially when you are trying to develop and want to get an idea of what are the different nodes and what are the type of the nodes and so on. And one thing I want to show is also that we up here has something called copy path, which is, can be really useful when you are working config API. So I'll show you that in a second. So let's try now to dive in and do some live coding, just to show you how relatively simple it actually is to get an application running and which does some configuration. What we want to do is that we want to go to do an analytics event. It's, you can say, one of the simpler types, and mainly for my safety here on stage that I have chosen that. But the concepts are pretty much the same for any other type of item in the system. So I have my Visual Studio here, and I want to create a new project. So we'll just do a console application because that's the simplest here. So let's do that. And I guess we can call it devconf. And let's try to create that. So the first thing we need to do once we are inside this project is that we need to add the web the service reference. So I already showed that on a previous slide. But let's see here. We go down and add a service reference. And the address was the one I showed you previously. I already have it on my clipboard, but it's this management server / configuration API service, in this case on my local machine because I have the VMS installed here. So let's go. And there's this configuration API service, which have the, this implements this iConfiguration service interface. So let's give it a better namespace than this one. So let's just call it config API. And let's try to add it to our project. So we now have it added to the project, and we try have a look at the objects that are automatically created by Studio simply based on the web service, the SOAP interface. And you can see here that we have some different error classes and so on. But interesting is that we have the configuration service interface, and we have a configuration service client, which is the client Studio creates for you. Okay, I said 15 methods. It seems like I was slightly wrong. It's more like 25 or something. But again, it's actually only 5 of these you really need to use. So let's try to jump to the code and make an instance of this client so we can get started communicating with the service. So let's just make a client. Oh, and before that, just to make it a bit easier for me, let me add a using for the namespace. So I think we call it devcons.config API. So now I should have, let's see if I I can get a little help. It's configuration service client. So we want to instantiate a new one of that. And it will need a name of a binding eventually. So we can just as well give it in the constructor. So the bindings have also been created by Studio. So if we go to the app config, we can see them here. And we have had two edits, one for basic users and one for AD users. Let's just take this one for the AD user. It's a bit simpler. So let's put it in here. And since what we want to do is that we want to create an analytics event, so the first thing we want to do is that we want to get hold of the analytics event folder. So let's try as the first thing we do to call the get item on the analytics event folder. And now we would like to have the path. It takes a path of the get item method. So let's quickly jump back to the config API client and go to the analytics events folder. You can see down here that the it's a fairly straightforward straightforward name or path. But I told you we have this copy path, so let's just use that. It's a lot easier. And now let's go back and put that in here. And let's put a breakpoint down here. And give it a go. So we have now hit the breakpoint, and let's try have a look at the object we got here. So first of all, you'll notice it's a configuration item. As I said, pretty much everything you get and work with here is configuration items. And one thing we want to look for here is that there are some methods IDs. So this one have two methods, one called add analytics event and one called remove analytics event. We want to add analytics event, so let's copy this value. And let's finish this one and give it another go. So what we'll do now is that we will try to invoke this method on the client. Or actually on the folder we had, so we'll now call the invoke method. And it takes two things. It takes the item we want to invoke the method on, so in this case it will be our analytics event folder. And it takes the name of the method, and we have that here. So add analytics event. So let's try to see what happens when we run once more. So we now got another configuration item, as you see. And as I maybe already indicated a bit, I called it an intermediate result. And the reason I did that is I knew what will come out of it. But when you get a result of a method, an invoke method, it can be two different item types. It can either be invoke info or it can be invoke result. Invoke info is in the cases where you actually are lacking some properties. So let's see down here in the properties what is missing. It's only missing one, so that's easy. And it wants a name. That makes very good sense since analytics event needs to have a name. So let's copy the value of this one and get back and update our code a bit more. So we would now like to set the value for this one. So let's take our intermediate result and look into the properties collection and find the first, there will only be one, but the first where pe.key equals name. And let's give it the value DC event. So now we have updated our object, so let's now try to do yet another invoke method. So let's say, and this time we'll do it on the intermediate result because that's the one that contains the updated property. And we would want to invoke the same method once again. And let's give it a go. So now we have a result, and hopefully you will now see that this has the item type of invoke result instead of the invoke info, meaning that now the method is actually completed. It still contains a number of properties, but these are now the filled out properties of the newly created of this newly created item, and it will give you some information, the ID of the new event and the time it was added and stuff like that. That's not so interesting right now, but let's allow this to finish and let's go to this management client. So previously I didn't have any analytics event, so let's try to refresh the configuration now and see what now we actually got an analytics event called DC event. As I said, this is one of the most simple types we have in the entire config API, but pretty much any other object can be created in the same way. So let's get back to the slides and have a look at one of the a lot more complex types of items. So we already did the live code demo, so let's move on to rule configuration. This is our latest addition. We added the first part of it, a smaller part in 2020 R1, and then the main part came in 2020 R2, and we have some large catch-ups in 2020 R3. But with 2020 R2 release, you actually have more or less the support for pretty much all rules. So the configuration API allows for adding, removing, and updating rules. And you can add them both in one go. So if you have all information, which we'll see on the next slide, how we do, you can just do it in one go. And I guess that's the most common scenario. But you can also do it more stepwise. You saw that I did the analytics event in two steps because I started without any parameters. And then it told me, oh, you need to add this. For rules, this makes a bit more sense because if you're familiar with management client, there's actually a number of steps involved in doing a rule. And for and a lot of the steps depend on what you have chosen in the previous one. For instance, the first thing you answer is, should it be time-based or event-based? Okay, if it's event-based, then you need to choose the type of event, like user-defined event. And so then you are to choose the event itself, and so on and so on. So there's a number of steps. And it makes quite a lot of sense to do that more wizard-like. But in many of your cases, I guess you know exactly the rule you want to create, and then you can also do it in one go. The node for this is called the rule folder, or the path for the main node is called rule folder. And one thing to note here is that we don't have any strongly typed classes for the rules part of config API. And this is mainly due to this very generic nature that all the properties depend very much on the other properties. So it's very hard to make a strongly typed class with hard-coded properties that covers all the different scenarios. So at least so far, we haven't been able to find a good way to do it as strongly typed classes. So here's an example, and I know it's a bit busy slide, but this shows you all the code needed to create a new rule. We are not going much in detail with it, but what I want you to notice is that it's very much the same as we just did for the analytics events, except that here we simply call set item just in one go because we know that we have set all the right values. I guess I should have been a bit more teaching a bit better than and actually called validator before I called set item. If you see here, you have an item, a configuration item, you add a number of properties, a bit more than the name, but also a name here. And in this case, you also need, of course, to decide what type is it. So it's an event-based in this case. What is the start event type? Okay, that's an input activated here, and so on and so on. So, but the principles is exactly the same. One hint, I mentioned before that I think that in most of your usage scenarios, you will know exactly which kind of rule you want to set up. And an easy way to do that would then be to create once in the management client to see, and then you can request it using the config API, and then you can actually have a look, okay, how does this one look? And and then you can basically copy that information, just update it with the values that make sense for the rule you're going to make. So we are coming to the end now. So I have here added a few references. First one is the introduction. By the way, if you notice, all of this is on our main documentation site, online doc.developer.milestonesys.com. First one is a fairly thorough introduction to configuration APIs. So it will describe how to work with a configuration API, pretty much similar to what I've been doing. And then it'll also go a bit into details with there are some certain things you should know when you work with rules and so on. Next one is the interface documentation. That's fairly simple because what you need here is mainly these five methods, and you already now know what it's about. But you can find the documentation for this interface here as well. Then I have listed two samples. There are a few more, but I listed two. One is the config API client, which you just saw, and the other one is the configuration API import, which will give you a better idea of how to do an application, a bit similar to what I've done here, except this one is about creating devices instead of analytics events. So with that said, now would be time for questions. So far there are none, but feel free to ask. Or feel free to go to developer.milestonesys.com, the forum we have there, and we'll be ready to answer that at a later time if something pops up. As we still have no questions, let's jump back just to a quick additional demo on the config API client. So going back to config API client, if you go to the rules part, if you see in here, as I said, it's the rule folder path, and you see here I have a fairly bare system, so I have just the normal predefined rules you probably know if you have ever worked with XProtect. And then I added one more, and this is actually the rule you saw the code for creating just before, so let's have a look at that. So you can see up here the name, I could change that if I want, and also description and so on. And then we have the start rule type, so that can be an interval, it can be event, or it can be a recurring rule type. Next you have, okay, what's the group? So in this case, it was a user-defined event that was chosen, but you can see there are all the other event types supported as well, and so on and so on. Next, you'll choose the event itself, and so on. You can also say what the stop rule, so what should stop the rule. In this case, there's no stop rule type, since it's just go to the home preset. But you could have a stop rule if it was something that had a duration and want to do something at the end. Finally, down here, you'll see the start actions. Stop actions are not shown because there are none here, but if there were stop actions, will be shown here, and you can also, of course, set them through the API. But if you look here at the actions, you can see all the different actions available, which are almost all. I think we have four or five left we don't support, and that's mainly because they depend on other types that are not currently available. It's quite edge case stuff. Like play an audio file and stuff like that. So, but we are also considering adding the last few. But all the main actions, I dare say, are already available here. So, that we got time for that small demo. But that's pretty much all I had for now. So, thanks a lot for joining, and enjoy the rest of the day.